And here we go. It's episode 4. Right out of the gate, it's Dying Scene Radio. I'm Bob Noxious. I'm staring over here at my buddy Bobby Pickles. How's it going, Bobby?
Hey, Bobbo. How you doing, buddy?
Hey, man.
What's up, man?
It's another day in paradise down here in the Sunshine State.
How's the weather down there? What's the temperature this week?
Do you really want to know?
Yes, I do. Please tell me.
Right now, it's 63 degrees.
You...
That's just the way that it is, Bobby. You're the one who chooses to live up there in the great white north.
I don't know why I decided to do it.
Why did you move out of there? I mean, you've told the story before when you moved to New York City days before you turned 30. Was that it right there? That's just it?
1 week before I turned 30, man. You know Ben Coletti, right?
Of course.
Bud Light beers all day long and just go to the beach and jump on boats all day, you know? And it's just a constant, endless array of debauchery. All right. How long could you keep up with that lifestyle, Bob, before you go crazy?
I've been doing it a lot longer than you have, Bobby Pickles.
Bob, I reached a point where I looked around at my surroundings. I saw I had been to every single beach bar. There's no place that I would go to where it'd be a new experience. Just the same thing over and over again. And I was just going stir crazy, man. I had to go.
You were hanging out in the wrong places, Bobby. First of all, you hang out at too many beach bars, listening to too much Jimmy Buffett and drinking too many margaritas and Bud Light with limes in it. You're bound to get a little bit lightheaded. So it's best to man up, head down to some dirty punk bar in the city, and just elbow up and get yourself a nice dark stout and just drink it up.
Absolutely, man. That puts me in the mood to listen to a little bit of punk rock music.
That's a great idea, man. And honestly, that's what we're here for. Because we're all just a bunch of bastard sons, aren't we, Bobby?
Yes, we are, my friend. We're bastard sons till the day we die.
Tell you what, buddy. Let's release the hounds and let's play this brand new track from the bastard sons called Release the Hounds.
Guns and don't be afraid. time for turning back. These songs are forever black.
Some brand new stuff right there from a band called Trails, Bobby. They're out of the UK, and they just released a video for that track right there called Forever Black. How'd you like that 8-bit little Atari gimmick they had there at the backside?
Well, you know, my generation, it was Nintendo, Bob, but you're a little older than me, so I'll give you the Atari.
2600, baby, with the joystick, the original joystick with the big red button.
You know what, Bob? I kid. I wasn't that old where I don't remember Atari.
I got to try and remember when I gave up the gaming system, you know, because I think my first game system was a game called Pong. And then after Pong, I went to the 2600, and then from there to the Commodore 64. And I guess I'm really dating myself with my references there. However, I was a gamer from way back, but I stopped playing when I picked up my first guitar and had my first beer, which is ironically on the same day. So at that point, I quit gaming, and I quit roller skating, and I dedicated my life to punk rock and beer.
Bob, you know what? You definitely did date yourself. Where were you roller skating, by the way? Was that Rainbow Roller Rink?
No, I didn't grow up on that side of the bay. I grew up on the Tampa side. So for me, it was Skate Odyssey North. What did you say it was?
The Rainbow Roller Rink.
Ah, that's right. Was that in Pinellas Park?
Off Olmerton Road, I guess.
Seminole. Largo.
Largo.
Larghetto.
Larghetto. Anyway, these people don't want to hear about this hillbilly Floridian rhetoric.
So you got out there, you beat the elements, you trundled through the snow, you got on a train, and you went to go meet the boys in Entropy. How was that?
No, I borrowed my mom's car, and me and the bum hightailed it to Warwick, New York, a little town up in the mountains by ski lodges. We had to go through Tuxedo, New York, Bob. Do you know where Tuxedo is?
Never heard of it.
That's where they invented the tuxedo, Bob. Look it up on Wikipedia. It looked exactly like The Shining. It was a foggy day. It was snowing. We were going up and down mountains. And honestly, I just had the thought of Jack Nicholson frozen to death with that crazy look on his face at the end of The Shining. That's what I was thinking of the whole time while I was driving up there.
The last time that I was in New York, Bobby, was probably 3 or 4 years ago. And we were in Amityville. And we were doing some work just, you know, maybe 5 to 6 miles from the legendary house where all those murders happened, the Amityville Horror House.
And that's on Long Island. Amityville, Long Island.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's right next to Bayshore. I have a friend in Bayshore, New York, which is like the next town over. So I know where that is.
So we, is it Bayshore or Bayside?
Bayshore.
Because there's a Bayside, too. I just don't know where the hell that's at, to be honest with you. But anyway.
Yeah.
We went.
That's Queens.
We went and we found that house. We actually Googled it. You know, we used the power of Google, found out the address, and went there. And it was so interesting, man, because, you know, when you see it in the movies and then you see it in real life and you know that it's based on a true story, and never mind the mumbo jumbo of all the paranormal activity that happened. I'm just talking like the murder that happened in the boathouse and seeing it. It was pretty cool, man. If you get a chance, watch out. The neighbors don't like it when you're in the neighborhood, though.
You have a twisted sense about you, Bob. Wow.
Why? To go
that
and
excited you to see a place where all these murders happen?
Because I saw the movie, and I've seen... Come on, Bobby. How many movies or miniseries or TV shows have you seen that somehow had told you the story of the Amityville Horror?
Honestly, you're probably a sick sociopath, man. I'm going to have to keep my eye on you.
Don't worry. The state already is. So, Bobby, let's check out this track from this band, Entropy, that you spoke with. We're going to be running the interview later on in the show. Here you go. Here's some Entropy, man. It's the OCHC. This is Meat Mattress right here, Dying Scene Radio.
We find those friends we gave up on. Let's dreams are bumps in the road. Some made to the service of mankind. Seems like a leap of faith. And if the ships we abandon still somehow find their way, we lose the legs we stand on. At least we know we try. Another path that's laid out. Get lost along the way. Energy at the end of the journey. Now I prove I'm okay. I find the ships I abandoned still occupy my mind. I'll lose the ground I stand on. At least we know we try.
Let me go!
That right there was the LA punk hardcore veterans rotting out. They got a brand new video for that song right there. It's called Burn, and you can check it out right here on dyingscene.com. By the way, that track is also going to be featured on the new EP that they're putting out called Reckoning. It's due out March 10th via Pure Noise. That's some awesome stuff, bro. That makes me want to break something, Bobby. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. It makes me want to jump in the pit and start getting crazy.
Yeah, man. Just get rid of some of the aggression, because there's a lot of messed up stuff in the world, and there's just weird stuff going on daily.
Are you a pit guy?
No.
Oh, I am.
Do you? You get down there? I will,
dude,
man.
I'll get
Listen,
crazy, man.
I like to get in the front. Don't get me wrong.
Hey, can I give you a story really quick, Bob?
Yeah.
The lead singer of Face to Face 1 year at Warped Tour pointed me out of everybody and said, "That guy is fucking awesome."
You should put that on like your webpage or your blog. You figure out what's that guy's name. And I think that'd be like a quote under Bobby Pickles, like put it in quotes. "That guy is awesome. Singer dude from Face to Face." Bobby, that's what we call street cred.
You're right, though. You bring up good point, though. Why don't I know names? Why don't I know things? I'm supposed to be doing the news. I'm supposed to be part of a punk rock podcast, and I'm absolutely ignorant on a lot of stuff, including tonight's first news story, Bob.
What's going on in the news? What do you got?
Well, awesome news for fans of The Replacements. The band has just announced a sting of reunion U.S. tour dates to take place this coming April and May. You can check out the full site of dates on dyingscene.com. The Replacements last released the covers EP, Songs for Slim, which was made to help pay medical bills for their former guitarist, Slim Dunlap. The band has considered making a new album, which will be their first since 1990's All Shook Down. Now, Bob, this is what I'm talking about, man. I mean, I go ahead and I admit this stuff. I don't know why. A better man would keep it covered up and not mention it, but I'll tell you the truth, I never heard of The Replacements.
Well, they started out back in the day in Minneapolis in 78, man, roundabout when punk rock was first coming around. Now, they weren't exactly like your Sex Pistols variety of punk rock, but, you know, Paul Westerberg, very influential singer, songwriter, started the band, put it together, him and Tommy Stinson, and one of them's brother, I think Tommy's brother. But anyway, they've been around for a long time. They're still around. I was just trying to figure out if they had some dates, because I'd heard that they were coming around or that they were doing some dates. Let's see. This week, they're playing San Francisco. If you're in San Francisco, check them out at the Knob Hill Masonic. They're in Los Angeles. They're in Denver. They're in Chicago. They're in Milwaukee. They're coming your way, bro. Pennsylvania. Oh, nope.
Philadelphia. That's the closest one.
Yep. Philadelphia. So, you know, check them out, man. Go and see a bit of music history right there. The Replacements. Good for them. What else you got, dude? You got some more stuff to talk about?
Awesome news, everyone. Wyoming pop-punk veterans Teenage Bottle Rocket have just announced details on their new album, Tales from Wyoming. It's going to be released March 31st, 2015. It will be the band's debut album on Rise Records. Here's what they had to say about the new album, Bob. "We worked hard with Jason Livermore and Andrew Berlin, engineering at The Blasting Room, and the one and only Bill Stevenson producing, and we cannot wait for everyone to hear it. Check out the track listing, as well as a new song titled Nothing Else Matters When I'm With You. You can find that on dyingscene.com. If you want to get your pre-orders, head over to tbr.merchnow.com. Tales from Wyoming serves as a follow-up to Teenage Bottle Rocket's last full-length album, Freak Out, which was released in 2012 on Fat Records. Now, Bob, I got a chance to listen to this song, and it really resonates with me, Bob. I love the lyrics talking about Metallica. I know this is a punk rock radio show, but I've seen Metallica 4 times. I love Metallica. What say you, Bob?
They definitely brought the reference into it, man. Not only with the title of the song, but also, and you guys will hear it here in a second because we're going to play it, but it even has the riff in there, man. So it's got the Metallica riffs in there. Is this the first you've heard of Teenage Bottle Rocket, or have you followed their career? Because this is their first record that they've done now for a major label.
Well, what about Fat Records?
They're an independent label. Rise Records is a major label. Pause. I want to make sure.
Really?
Yeah, I want to make sure that Rise Records is before I go on record saying that.
I should just put you on record right now. Ooh. Bob on record said that Rise Records was a major recording label. Let's see if Bob is correct, because he thinks he
I don't think it is, dude. I think I'm wrong. That's why I want...
Oh, yeah, that's right, Bob! Don't ever try to put me in a position where you're teaching me things.
I caught myself. I wasn't going to go on record saying that. I said,
it's okay, Bob. It's all good. You got a mulligan. You caught it.
Hey. It is a bigger label, though.
They run Fat Records. Now they're on this. Whatever. The fact of the matter is, Bob, that you know what? I have heard of Teenage Bottle Rocket before. I didn't really listen to the music that much, but I liked it.
I love Teenage Bottle Rocket. They're one of my favorite bands, Bobby. They're a great, live, energetic band. By the way, as a sidebar, check out the Lillingtons if you like them.
Okay, I will. I'll report back on that next week.
Cody, the guitar player from Teenage Bottle Rocket, he plays on the Lillingtons. So it's a very similar sounding band, but equally awesome. So this track right here, this is brand new stuff right here. And it's a complete, total nod towards Metallica. Right, Bobby?
How many times have you seen Metallica?
Probably two or three. Well, I saw Monsters of Rock. Yeah, probably three times.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, I've seen them, you know. I've seen them in their heyday. You couldn't get me to walk through the door to go see them now, though. I have no interest.
You didn't see the last documentary that was out recently? It's a live concert, but they have a storyline going along with it about their rookie roadie, and he has to go do crazy shit while this concert's going on, and it's all intertwined with it. It's pretty gnarly, man.
If I want to go see a rookie Metallica roadie, all I got to do is head down to Pinellas Park to the bus station, and I'm ready to go. Here's the Teenage Bottle Rocket right here. It's Dying Scene Radio.
Nothing else matters when I'm with you.
There you go. That track right there is from a band called Giving In, and the song's called Darkness Is the Only Quilt That I Need. Bobby, I found that band just, you know, kind of perusing through the dyingscene.com website. They're out of Canada. They're like a skate punk band. That's how they described themselves. Would you agree?
Well, what the hell is skate punk, quote unquote?
What is skate punk?
What would constitute a skate punk, Bob? In your humble opinion, because you're the all-knowledgeable Bob Noxious.
Like, as far as current day bands, who would I label skate punk?
The all-knowledgeable Bob Noxious.
I would say the Teenage Bottle Rockets very much skate punk. They've brought that sound from the 90s and, you know, kept it current.
Oh, so that's what skate punk is to you. So giving in
to me. Yeah, I mean, it's skate punk. You know, it's very riffy. That's what they call themselves. I listened. I concur.
If you want to call it skate punk, whatever.
Hey,
I just call it.
I am not the guy who goes putting names and pigeonholing bands by
giving them name-defining genres. You said it, my friend. I didn't say it.
Not me. Look up who wrote this article on dyingscene.com.
I can say one thing about that song, though. Darkness is the only quilt that I need. That is quite poetic song title, Bob. I wonder what that means, metaphorically.
Darkness gives him the feeling of warmth.
I'll tell you what lights up my life, Bobbo. Russian girlfriends.
Is that one of the websites that you've been visiting recently, dude? Because I would have never known in a city of 6 million you'd have to go find love online.
No comment, Bob.
Did I touch on a touchy subject?
No.
Yeah. We'll get back to the Russian girlfriends in just a second. But first, why don't you give me some more of that punk rock news and tell me what's been going on in this world this week.
You know the band Rise Against?
Of course.
Of course. I do too, Bob, even though I'm challenged intellectually. Chicago punk veterans Rise Against posted a cryptic picture of a 7-inch with a blank white label on their Facebook page earlier this week. And the photo's caption was just a crazy mix of question marks and hashtag RSD, hashtag stay tuned, hashtag rise against, suggesting the band will be releasing a 7-inch of some sort this record store day, April 18th. I'll keep you posted if any more details come to light.
Yeah, well, it would seem like that would make some sense, Bobby. You know, April 18th or whenever it is, April 20th, it's right around the corner. I'm not sure if I'm mixing up my favorite holiday or whether I'm mixing up record store day, but one way or the other, tis the season if you're in a punk rock band, or if you're a musician these days. Let's put some vinyl out and let's slap it in the record stores. That's it? That's all you got for me? You've got to have some more news than that, Bobby.
Hey, hold on, Bob. I got some more. Strung Out. Do you know that band, Bob?
I love Strung Out. I think they're a great band.
All right, great. They just announced a North American tour with Masked Intruder, Red City Radio, and La Armada. Well, I remember La Armada from a couple of weeks ago when we played one of their songs. I specifically remember them being a Spanish-speaking band, but they live here in, I believe it's Chicago. I think that's where they're from. See, Bob, how this works? As I go, I learn, and then I usually remember all the facts. That's how I operate. But anyway, California punk veterans Strung Out have announced they will be touring North America in support of the release of their highly anticipated new album, Transmission Alpha Delta. Full details on when and where the tour dubbed the Transmission to the Nation tour will be stopping can be found on dyingscene.com. It's through April and May, Bob. April 2nd, the tour starts, and it goes to May 22nd. And it pretty much goes all over the country. It hits St. Petersburg, Florida down there in the nation's penis. Before that, it creeps along Moist Armpit, hits the Gramercy Theater in New York.
Well, I do believe that Russian girlfriends will be on at least one of those dates on that tour, because when we talked to them, they mentioned that, indeed, they will be playing with some Masked Intruder. So look for them if you're in the neighborhood. Well, speaking of Russian girlfriends, you know, this week's band spotlight for the Dying Scene radio show is Russian girlfriends.
It's pretty interesting that you picked that band. What were you up to? Some different kind of research, and then you just happened to stumble on Dying Scene-related stuff? Or what? How did that happen?
I'll never tell, man. I'll never tell. But I will tell you how I found Russian girlfriends. There was a post about the band on dyingscene.com. And they had some music that was available. So I listened to it and found out that it was $1,000 that they were selling their MP3 single for. I thought that was unheard of.
$1,000, Bob.
$1,000. So I went on to read that it was one of the guys from the Coffin Cats, which is a psychobilly punk band, and another guy from Forbidden. And I thought to myself, man, I can remember when I was in high school, there was a band called Forbidden. They had a record called Twist Into Form. It was very vivid in my head, Bobby. And I thought, there's no way that there's a psychobilly band guy and like this, like San Francisco based, you know, just like, you know, Metallica was back then, you know, back in the day type of stuff then, you know, that kind of band, you know, Forbidden. No way.
So, Bob, wait. So basically they were members of these different bands that you remember from back.
Two different bands. Well, I mean, the Coffin Cats are current. They've been around for a while. You know, Forbidden's been around for, man, 25, 30 years. Who knows, man? Forever. I thought, okay, maybe it's a different Forbidden. Certainly by now, you know, that band's long gone or whatever. Turns out, Bobby, that it's, no shit, the drummer from Forbidden, metal band, kick ass, old school.
So this guy happens to live in Albuquerque, New Mexico?
We didn't get into it, but...
We should have asked that.
Well, we tried, but... We were all over the place in that. We talked to him.
I'll go ahead and admit that I was drinking a little bit while we were talking. I was feeling a little loose. Drinking my Bud Light here, enjoying myself, but being professional at the same time. These guys took it to a different level, though, and that's on them.
Are you calling them unprofessional?
Not at all. They were great. This is all jest. Everything that you're about to hear was in jest, and, you know.
Are you making disclaimers already, Bobby?
I am. Now, on behalf of Dying Scene Radio, I indemnify the show and DyingScene.com. For anything that Russian girlfriends may or may not have revealed or said.
Do we gotta go there? From this point on, I plead the fifth. Let's play the tape.
Dying Scene Radio. Band slot light.
Yo!
What's happening, fellas?
I'm Bobby, and that bearded gentleman with the red hair is Bob.
Nice to meet you, Bobby.
Hi, guys.
So we know who we're talking to. You guys just go around, Rob, and introduce yourselves.
Sadly, we couldn't all make it, but I'm Ian, one of the guitar players.
I'm Colin. I'm the other guitar player.
And I'm Adam. I'm the only non-guitar player in the band and the vocalist and one of the songwriters out of five.
Yeah, and then, unfortunately, Sasha and Jeremy couldn't make it.
That's okay. Well, welcome, guys. You guys are where, in Albuquerque?
That's right.
Yes, sir.
Awesome, man. So Russian girlfriends, man, let me tell you what. I Googled you guys on the interwebs, and they wanted my credit card. So
thank you for your donation.
You're welcome.
Yeah, do you get a lot of creep with ulterior motives hitting you up on Facebook?
Even to this day, like, I checked it, and our last 15 likes are all guys from the Middle East. And I'm not kidding. So whenever we finally get an album out, we're at least going to have a really good international following. And then the messages get really weird. We write songs about them now. So.
What's that shit you're drinking?
Bob, how do you talk about the beautiful nectar, which is Bud Light?
Bobby was down visiting in Florida a couple of weeks ago, and we went out on a boat in the middle of nowhere in January, and nothing but Bud Light in there. I ain't going to complain, man. It was beer, but Bobby Pickles was puking off the side of the boat because he had too many Bud Lights.
Thanks a lot, Bob.
I'm sorry, Bobby. I got to call you out on that, man. That was too much.
Bob, thanks for throwing me underneath the bus or the boat or whatever. let me ask you guys. I know you guys are out there in the desert. How is the beer out there in the punk scene also? I'm asking a two-part question.
I don't know about the punk scene, but as far as the beer out here, it's amazing. We have, like, New Mexico has, for whatever reason, become a new frontier of local breweries. And it's a big IPA community for whatever reason, probably because of the raising of estrogen levels that happens. But
out here in Albuquerque, we've got a really, really good general rock scene. As far as, like, punk rock goes, it's up and down for kids these days. We've got a lot of really, really good bands, and we've got a long punk rock history here. Like
ever since the Pueblo Revolt in 1680. That was, like, the most punk rock thing to happen in American history.
That and Scared of Chaka.
Yeah,
Scared of Chaka is also in there.
Are they from Albuquerque? I've heard of them.
Yeah, they're great.
Who else is from Albuquerque that we would all know about? I mean, I've been watching Better Call Saul.
Did you see that, Bob?
I did.
Was it good?
It was okay. Anybody else famous out of Albuquerque or anybody noteworthy? Who's got a good wiki page from Albuquerque?
Legions of Lore. We're actually playing with them on Friday. They're good friends of ours, and they're touring out a lot. Dean Stockwell lives in Taos. I don't know if you're familiar with Dean Stockwell.
Quantum Leap.
Val Kilmer used to live in Taos as well, I think. And then there's old bands that everybody may have heard of. There's the Eyeliners.
I got somebody. How about Mark Maron? He's a podcaster, Bob.
Mark Maron. Yeah, I forgot about him. That's awesome.
I did not know that.
As long as we're on this kick about Albuquerque, I mean, hey, I did a little Google search in Albuquerque too, Bobbo, and we got the Trinity site, the first spot where they detonated a nuclear device.
It was all developed in Los Alamos.
Los Alamos.
Sandia Labs and stuff.
That's right. And double and triple rainbows, Bob. I don't know if you saw that, but
they have
those out there, apparently. Double rainbows.
They also have – we're a very existential state. Like, we have signs on the highways that say, gusty winds may exist.
Do you really?
But yes. That's inside my car.
They also tell you not to pick up hitchhikers because of the prisons nearby. So I don't know.
There's not really a punk scene out there? Because you kind of, when I asked you about that, you just said, what punk scene? Really? Is
well, well, he's, that's he's, just a cynical,
he's just a cynical asshole. There is. I mean, that's what me and Colin, at least, we grew up like in the punk scene here in town. And we were both in punk bands the whole time. The 12 Step Rebels was a psychobilly band that came out of here, and that they were like one of the first ones in the United States to start. I mean, besides the classics like the Quakes and people that have been doing it forever, but as far as New Mexico and Arizona and Texas region goes, they helped promote a lot of the horror punk scene and things like that back in the day.
What happened to these bands that you guys all were ex-members of, the Coffin Cats, Forbidden, and Glitter Dick? Talking about like horror punk just now, is that what the Coffin Cats and Forbidden kind of were?
No, hold on.
Forbidden is actually a European metal band, like a
they're from the Bay Area.
Oh, Bay Area.
I was gonna ask how you guys got the drummer for Forbidden and then, you know, some rockabilly, you know, psychobilly stuff, and then you guys, how does that all mesh together? It's like, you know, one plus the other equals you guys.
Well, the rockabilly thing was that was more
shut the fuck up.
That was like a dirty college phase for me. But I left the Coffin Cats last year and moved back home to Albuquerque because they're a Detroit-based band. And I've been playing in bands with him forever before that and really wanted to do more projects with Colin. And Adam's a badass. He won't tell you, but he's fucking awesome.
Well, that's because you won't shut the fuck up. Like,
he won't say anything.
He's modest.
So I didn't grow up in Albuquerque. I grew up in South Dakota in the Midwest. So I grew up with Replacements, Husker Du, that kind of Midwest punk rock scene. I've lived in Albuquerque now a total of 10 years or more, but I've lived here two different times. And it was awesome because coming back the second time was really, we ended up meeting these fuckers, and now everybody's influence works. And that's the other great thing, is because of having so many influences and everybody being talented and, like, comprehensive songwriters and stuff, like, it makes it almost easier to, like, just see the creativity sprout, you know, because every single member of the band is bringing such a great element forth to make it just definitely the best rock and roll project I've ever been a part of. So.
How long have you been together now?
6 months.
Six, 7 months, yeah.
Right. And then there's only one unmastered song out right now that you have streamable. Yeah,
if we had another day or two, Bobby, they got some more stuff coming our way, but, you know, we're powering through.
On Thursday, we should actually be getting the entire album back and mastered.
Let us debut it.
Depending on who we find to maybe help us put it out. I know Dying Scene has a label. Just
you're such a
it out there.
We'll put it into good word. Hey, I got a quick question for you. So you got a single on Bandcamp, and I got to ask you about the price that you're asking for it.
Yeah.
This is something I've never seen before, and it's rather unique.
I have no idea what they're talking about.
It's $1,000 you're selling your single for.
Well, we're full of ourselves. So.
I did buy a copy so we could play some stuff tonight, so the check should be coming your way.
We don't understand technology, and apparently you have to sell tracks on Bandcamp. So we didn't want anyone to have it, so we just made it as much as we possibly could. If someone wants to throw out $1,000 to get the song, then good for them.
I've never seen that much money in my entire fucking life. So I feel like, seriously, I don't know.
You guys can retire once that first check comes in.
Then we'd be like, well, we'll put the album out ourselves.
Yeah.
Hey, listen, guys, talk to me about this name, Russian Girlfriends. I fucking love that name, and I love the logo, too, by the way. What is it called, the Mattresska? The Russian nesting doll?
Yeah.
That was designed by a local artist named Chisholm Lujan. He's a buddy of ours. We wanted something Russian-y and New Mexican-y at the same time.
Did you say his name is Chisholm?
Chisholm is his name.
Chisholm. It's a C-H.
What's up, Chisholm?
Adam, in directly came up with the name.
Me, Ian, and Colin were all in a band together about 7 months ago before we decided to stop that and do this project. And we were on tour, and we were up in French Canada, and we were getting ready to play the Bovine Sex Club.
Toronto.
The club, man. I didn't see any cows or fucking, but still.
It's an awesome punk rock club in Toronto.
So anyway, we had just played Poozafest, and there was a guy at Poozafest whose job was literally like, you text fun to his phone, and he shows up with a bag full of several different kinds of drugs. And so he showed up, and, you know, me being the hippie Albuquerque that I am, like, I decided to buy a bag of weed because, you know, why not? You know, it's cannabis. It's legal. That's why they have drug dealers. Anyway.
Sure.
So I had this huge bag of weed that I had to get rid of in like 2 fucking days. And it was really good. And that's kind of a stupid point of the story. But we're getting ready to play this show at Bowen Sex Club. So to prepare for the show, and because I have this fucking bag of weed I need to get rid of before we cross back in the United States, I just roll this huge fucking joint, and I'm like, all right, I'm going to go get fucked up before we fucking have to go back on stage. And Ian's like, I'm going to go out with you. And so I proceed to get as high as I fucking possibly can, and he starts talking to me about, well, you take it from here, because I can't. Yeah, at that point, I was fine.
It's all a haze from there.
I'm good friends with a lot of the members of the band, The Creep Show, based out of Toronto. And I was like, it's too bad they're on tour in Europe right now. I'd love to go see my friend Ginty. And then he's got this awesome Russian girlfriend. And Adam, right at that moment, like, just finishes taking a huge rip from his joint and goes, oh, fucking Russian girlfriends, man. It made me laugh so hard I almost fell into the street. And it was our inside joke for the rest of the tour. And we came home, and when it came time to decide names for this band, that was the first thing that anyone said and the only thing that anyone agreed on. And
we were too lazy to come up with anything else.
Yeah. I was going to say, now that we just told that story out loud, I'm really fucking embarrassed about
it. I have two thoughts. One thought is, hey, Bob, that's awesome, man. We indirectly got a road story out of this, right? Because one of our themes is we always ask everybody to give us a crazy or ridiculous story on the road, and you guys haven't been together that long, so I really wasn't going to ask it. But then number two, what's wrong with Polish girlfriends or maybe like a Czech girlfriend? Why Russian?
Oh, no, I don't even want to get into it about fucking Czech girlfriends.
You racist son of a bitch!
There's nothing wrong with any Slavic women. We are totally in.
Actually, the new name of the band is Slavic Women.
Slavic.
Okay,
this just in on dyingscene.com.
To keep everybody honest, there is another band out there. They're called Russian Girlfriend. Have you guys seen these guys?
It's a DJ.
It's a DJ named Russian
Okay,
Girlfriend.
Are you sure?
And if he comes to Albuquerque, he's getting a beat down.
Check it out. It's Russian Girlfriend. Singular, not plural.
Yeah, I found it also.
From Coventry, UK.
Another dude posing as a Russian girlfriend.
No, it's actually a band, and there's also a guy named Ian in the band.
Whoa, weird.
Wait, what?
Maybe.
I swear to God, there's also a guy named Ian.
You know, he never knew what he did on Sunday evenings, and now I'm kind of...
You got to watch out for that Ian fella.
Do you have, like, a track?
Yeah, what kind of music?
I'll send you... It says, display of power mixed with an evocative subtlety, affecting audiences on a primal, almost subliminal level. Influences throughout the musical spectrum. I swear to God, it's on here.
They win.
He stole our fucking...
Actually, no. Guys, they didn't steal your name. It's okay. I've done interviews
with our imagery. That's all I'm saying. It's like, it's not about the name.
Okay. No. I've done interviews with bands that have the same exact name as another band. And nobody gives a shit.
The Creep Show was an Albuquerque band first.
Oh, fuck you.
And no, they were. I have friends in a band called The Creep Show, and when I became friends with the Toronto Creep Show, we started talking, and they're like, oh, yeah, actually, they had the name first, and they could have sued us and got, you know, what the cost of a punk band name gets you. But
it's happened numerous times. I mean, actually, on this episode right now, we're going to feature another interview where I interview a band called Entropy in New York. And there's another band called Entropy over in California, and they've been going at it, hardcore punk, same genre, since 1985 or something. So, and then Barroom Heroes, I interviewed the Barroom Heroes in Boston. And there's another Barroom Heroes in Germany.
There's Barroom Heroes in every town across the world.
God damn.
That's a franchise.
If you ever end up talking to this other Ian, then let him know I'm calling him out.
Let's I don't think they're punk rock, though.
Bobby, do we have time to set up a dual interview? We can call these guys up and get them all on a three-way call?
I'm still down
for it. Yeah, let's cold call him.
Their most current website links to MySpace, so I don't know.
Mm.
That's big in Europe still, though, says the guy who's been to Europe one time.
Actually, the last entry was 2008.
So that was my old band.
You guys are plural. They're singular. They're 2008. You're 2015. Let's move forward, all right? Bob, what are we playing?
Well, they only got one track that's available. It's the one that cost me $1,000 on my company credit card.
Like we said, thanks for the donation.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
I just paid my credit cards off thanks to punk rock.
We're going to send you more songs.
You're going to send us more songs?
Yeah. Full masters are back on Thursday.
Can we drop a song like brand new?
Yeah, definitely.
This comes out on Friday morning. If you give it to me Thursday night, we can get it in there.
We'll surprise you.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
So, hey, when you guys get these new mastered tracks, what's the plan of what you're going to do with the record? You guys pick it up, hitting the road for a bit?
We've had the record for a couple months now, and so we're kind of trying to shop it around a little bit to see if we can find the right label to kind of help us release it. Yeah. And in the event that doesn't happen, we will release it ourselves and set up some tours and start going from there.
Is Sasha still playing in Forbidden?
Yes.
He actually just got back from playing with Heathen on the 70,000 Tons of Metal tour, too.
Kick ass on the fucking big boat out in the middle of nowhere playing metal all night.
Seriously, the best fucking drummer I, at least personally, have ever fucking played with. That guy is amazing. We super lucked out. Not only he's an incredible musician, incredible drummer, and he writes fucking songs, too. So there you go.
And we're pretty convinced he's Spider-Man as well.
Because he's got his arms everywhere and he just grabs stuff, or what?
His entire body is a muscle. It's really creepy.
Yeah, he's like one sinewy, like, blob of power. Like, I don't know.
He's trying to join the podcast, actually.
Is he?
He would be like, you missed all this great stuff, Sasha.
We called you a piece of beef jerky. Fucking Russian girlfriends, man.
Fucking Russian girlfriends.
Well, hey, man. It's great talking to you guys. And how do we find you guys on the web in the meantime? You guys just doing the Bandcamp thing and Facebook or any other way? You got a website?
Bandcamp, Facebook for now. When things start to progress a little bit further, we'll obviously start doing our own webpage. But that's probably not going to happen until summertime.
We have a video ready to release with the album. We're going to be doing in our friend Mario Rivera, who we've worked with before, has this thing called the 909 sessions, which is like acoustic sessions with bands. And so we're getting ready to do one of those as well, which should be on YouTube and as soon as we can get it up.
People should check that out already. Anyway, he's got the lead singer of the Ataris has already done one with him. The Shell Corporation. Everybody should check it out.
It's great stuff. Filming, great music.
909 sessions, facebook.com/RussianGirlfriends. Find us on the Bandcamp, and then very soon there will be a lot more coming out of us, which sounds a lot creepier than I am.
Talking about a creep show right
Russian
there.
Russian girlfriends, man.
Well, listen, man, it's great talking to you guys. Those of you Googling Russian girlfriends, click on the second item if you want to find these guys. Number one's going to cost you a little bit more than $1,000, all right? But well worth the money either way.
We're also really happy to be doing this.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
No problem, man. We're glad to have you guys.
Hopefully we will help revive a dying scene. Can you, like, have someone overdub the interview that's not us, that sound intelligent and maybe play good music?
Yeah, have Richard Dreyfuss do Adam's voice.
Thank you.
I want to be played by Steve Zahn.
If you continue to ignore this particular problem, it's going to swim around and bite you in the ass.
I didn't get that reference.
Mr. Holland's Opus.
Yeah.
It went over my head too, Bobby. I have no idea. I've heard of these things, but I never thought of watching them.
We based the band on Mr. Holland's Opus, really.
Mr. Holland's Opus.
Now, this is part two of the band name right here.
Bus. No one wears
changes it up just a little bit right there, Bobby. That was the swing folk punk act Rusty Things doing their track called El Toro con Alas, whatever that means. I don't carry my pocket thesaurus. Wait a minute, yes I do, I got a smartphone. Anyway, they just released a music video for that track, and you can check it out on dyingscene.com. And Bobby, man, it was so cool to be able to world premiere Russian Girlfriends doing Tad Kubler.
That was a first for us.
So much for the witness protection program for the Russian Girlfriends. Anyway, man, really awesome dudes, man. Right, Bobby?
Absolutely, man. They were awesome. Great guys.
Well, you got any more news over there? You got some more stuff on the desk over there? I see some more papers you've been shuffling around over there. Must be some more stuff happening in the world besides Kanye West. What do you got?
Do you know the band The Decline from Australia, Bob?
I think I've heard of the name. I've also heard of the NOFX song that lasts like 18 minutes.
I've heard of that song too, Bob. It's awesome. Are you a fan of that song?
I used to do pirate radio back in the day, and it was live. And that was the punk rock version of Stairway to Heaven, which back in the 70s when FM radio first came around, whenever the DJ had to go and take a crap, he would put Stairway to Heaven on. He had 7 or 8 minutes to go out and do that. For me, I did these 4 and 5 hour stretches of live radio. You get hungry. You get the munchies. You want to get something to eat. That would be my go-to song. That gave me 18 minutes to go downstairs to the pizza joint, which is a 5-star pizza, run downstairs, pick up some wings, destroy those said wings, take a quick leak behind the building, as well as other things probably that I shouldn't talk about behind the building, and then get back up there with, you know, my greasy chicken fingers and slide the knobs on the faders. And, you know, play punk rock on the FM radio. But yeah, great song. We're not going to play it here. It would take up most of the show.
Listen, it's a great song. And obviously, there would be a band born somewhere in this world. Apparently, it's Australia that decided to make it the name of their punk band, Bob. And they are fucking good. I checked them out. They're awesome. I mean, they're a really good band. They have a really good sound. But apparently, they have some new members. So that's what the news is about, Bob. They announced new members, 2 new members, actually, out of the 4-piece. But they also announced that with their 2 new members, they announced that they will be entering Fremantle's Electric City Studios this week to begin tracking their long-awaited 3rd album. Adam Round and Sam Allen, who worked on the band's previous releases, 2011's Are You Gonna Eat That and 2014's Can I Borrow a Feeling. After the recent departure of Dan Cribb and Nathan Cooper, The Decline are pleased to welcome 2 new members into the mix, Ben Elliott on guitar and vocals, and Ray. Wow, that's crazy. They changed up the vocals too? That's not like just changing up a guitar or a bassist. That's changing up like the whole sound, in my opinion, right, Bob? How do you feel about that?
I think they should change their name.
Yeah?
That's it.
Yeah. At that point, you're a different band, right?
Move on, guys. Let's move on to the next track, too, Bobby, because I got better stuff to talk about.
I read you loud and clear, Bob. I'll try to find more interesting topics to suit your news, Mr. All-Knowing Bob.
You're killing me. Okay, Bobby, you've been bringing me these stories. I need you to give me some real news here, man. What can you tell me?
Bob, I got something to pique your interest. A track list, cover art, and a release date has been announced for the Rancid tribute album, Hooligans United. I'm excited for this release, Bob. Hooligans United, it's a Rancid tribute album that has been in the works for quite some time, and it looks like the pipe dream is finally becoming a reality. The album features 54 fantastic punk and ska bands covering 54 Rancid classics, and it will be released April 14th via Smelvis Records. Pre-releases have already begun. Check out the phenomenal track list and promo video for the release on dyingscene.com. You know, which songs are you most excited about? We'd love to hear it. Shoot an email over to bobbypickles@dyingscene.com and let me know which track you are the most excited to hear. Because I love Rancid, and I'm sure Bob does. Or maybe Bob be more inclined for The Decline. Who should cover that song, Bob? Pigpen should cover that song, Bob.
There was actually a local band that played here in my home area. Well, they played in St. Pete, actually, which is right across the bay from me. So they do this, it's called Under the Covers, where they get local bands to take on the persona of a famous band and play that band's covers for one night only. And there's a band called No Talent, and they did NOFX. And, of course, they had to do The Decline in there. It was fantastic. It was an A-plus job well done. Those types of songs can only be played once because they're a magic memory that's made, and then you can't do it ever again because it gets really boring, I'm sure.
You like Rancid, right, Bob?
Of course I like Rancid, man. I love Rancid. Rancid's been around forever.
Would you say Rancid was an influence on Pigpen?
Sure, to some degree. We've ripped off a couple chord progressions from them.
All right, nice. Good to hear, Bob.
Steal from your favorite artists. That's what everybody else does, right?
Good artists copy, great artists steal.
Steal. That's my mantra. Hey, maybe these guys right here should do a Rancid cover. Here's a new band called Gutter Life, and they got a brand new video for this track right here called Complacent. Maybe they don't do the Rancid cover song, but they do have this brand new record coming out on February 17th, which is this coming Tuesday. DyingScene.com has your links. Here's the track. It's Dying Scene Radio. Gutter Life. Complacent.
Girlfriends here on Dying Scene Radio!
Yeah.
And that track right there, kind of weird, right? The band is called Strange Times, and the track is called Eat Your Leaders. Now, this New York City punk band, Bobby, you need to go find these guys. And I'm going to give you some homework because I'm about to take you to school, okay? I'm going to say two words to you, Bobby, and I want you to tell me the first thing that comes to your mind. Crack rock.
Ben Coletti.
I can see already we're going in the wrong direction. Crack rock is a musical style that was made famous by bands like Leftover Crack and Choking Victim and Morning Glory. And I'm taking you to school right here, Bobby, so I hope that you're paying attention. Very important bands, very influential on the crack rock sound. Now, this band right here, Strange Times, produced none other than by Mr. Ezra Kyer of all those aforementioned bands. So this is the real deal stuff here, man. And the brand new record, it just came out. Eat Your Leaders is the follow-up to their debut EP. I hope you dug it, man. That's good stuff. So, Bobby, get your press cap and get ready to run because I have an assignment for you, okay? I need you right away. You're in New York City already. Go out and find yourself the nearest crack rock band. It doesn't have to be anybody from Leftover Crack or Choking Victim, but that would be super awesome for our listeners, I'm sure. If you want to go out and find Strange Times, I'm sure that you can find them, but there is a whole legion of bands that are grandfathered underneath Leftover Crack, Choking Victim, and Morning Glory. Go find yourself some crack rock, boy. Go.
I will, Bob. And speaking of doing these interviews and stuff and speaking with different bands throughout the world, as we were talking earlier, this week I went and I met with Orange County, New York hardcore punk band Entropy. I met them at a place called the Tuscan Cafe. The full video can be viewed on our YouTube page, youtube.com/dyingsceneradio. We have the whole interview for all of these interviews that we do here on the show. It's all there for you to see in high definition. Right, Bob?
Pretty much any interview that we can do that we feel is suitable for our audience, we post it right there on our YouTube page. You'll find it youtube.com/dyingsceneradio. So I'm really excited to hear what these guys have to say, Bobby. Can we go ahead and listen now?
Do you want me to make all your decisions for you? Okay, yes, let's do it now. Listen to my ridiculous blathering conversation with, how'd you say it, Bob? OCHC.
That's the Orange County hardcore right there, brother. Represent.
Yeah, it was crazy driving up here, actually. I mean, went through Tuxedo. It looked like The Shining on the way up here. It was pretty...
You passed like Sterling Forest and the Renaissance Fair and stuff like that.
Yeah, ski lodges and stuff like that. I just got... mass murder had to have happened.
That's where they had the Renaissance Fair. That's
yeah, you have to look out for albino people that try to pull you over and act like they're cops, but really they just want to molest you.
Is that true?
No.
Little-known fact...
I mean, I can't say it doesn't happen.
Little-known fact as well, Oprah Winfrey has a house out there.
Apparently,
really?
Ben Affleck did as well for
and
a little while.
I have been on the O Channel zero times. Which is ridiculous.
So talk to me about the band. You guys, the band's called Entropy. And how'd you come up with the name, Entropy?
Well, honestly, we've gone through quite a few ideas. And we were looking for a name that more bands had than any other band on Earth. So we went with Entropy, which we're basically forming like a United Nations of bands with currently. But if you like hardcore punk, which is what we play, there's a really good band called Entropy. It's been playing hardcore punk from Southern California since the mid-80s.
It's the same name?
Yeah, oh yeah.
Now, how does that?
They're better at it than we are, too.
What is that now? What is that? Have you ever considered changing the name because
of
somebody
else? We put NY at the end of it, so we don't have to.
So that makes it all better.
If you're a lawyer on Facebook, we're Entropy NY.
Now, isn't the name of the new album something about no plagiarism, and you guys stole somebody else's name? I mean, what the hell is that about?
Yeah, yeah. I also stole the logo. It's supposed to be ironic, but we're not quite intelligent enough to reach irony, so it's silly. That's a level we're happy to be at. It's like more Leslie Nielsen.
Let's introduce everybody, if we could. Can you guys tell me your names and what you play in the band?
I'm Brian, and I'm vocals.
Patrick, I play guitar.
I'm Brian, and I play drums.
I'm Colin, and I'm the guy they let play bass.
For now.
And you said the band's been together since 2012, is that right?
Yeah, just over 2 years.
And so you just released your new LP?
All Work, No Plagiarism.
Tell me about the music scene up here in Orange County, New York.
Well, Orange County, New York has had a diverse scene for a long time. Originally, we had both All Out War in the mid-90s, which is hardcore, and then we had bands like Cooter Lounge, which were more pop punk, and and back in those days, we would have shows that were mixed, ska, punk, and I'm really old, so I remember that time, but... through the years,
how old are you, man?
I am 35.
Oh my God, that's my age. No,
thanks,
man.
Thanks for making me say that.
That's my age too, man.
Yeah, no, it's okay. I mean, we're gonna die soon, but yeah, we're alive now, so I'm just gonna talk about the old days. I was wearing an onion on my belt because that was the style at the time. But yeah, we've always had mixed shows, and we have a pretty mixed scene currently. And like just tonight, there's a pop punk band, there's a folk punk band, there's whatever the fuck we do.
There's a poet.
Is a poet also?
Sort of. I mean, you see him. He's if you pretentious call enough, him but he's not like talented.
So, what would you characterize your sound as?
We're hardcore punk.
I would say hardcore punk.
Yeah. Well, like 80s hardcore punk.
With the exception of the bonus track, right?
Right.
Yeah.
We're kind of sorry we did that now.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Do you have a lot
of many people took it seriously?
Do you have a lot of people like asking you to make songs like that? Because I know you're probably going to hate me right now. Based, I'm sure this is a joke or the inside joke or whatever. But I like that song, man. That was,
well,
that was
everybody does.
On the record, man.
I don't know if it was a joke. I mean, Brian had been in a ska band with my guy over there for a good 15 years.
Yeah.
10, somewhere 10, in the 12-ish.
15.
Pat had played with Brian in a ska punk band. And Colin, I don't know. I think we found him here. But I've hated ska for a long time, so that was cool.
Oh, yeah.
But, I mean, you know.
Well, you do it well.
Well, these guys did. I just sang. I just wrote words.
I love your vocals, man. Your vocals are very, you know, it's very interesting. It's different. It's not like a lot of other bands. You know, how did you shape your voice and stuff? What'd you say?
Honestly, I've just been doing it a long time, and that's what came out.
Yeah, it's
I didn't
cool.
always like my voice, but, you know, I've had a good 16 years to work
we
on
still
it.
Don't,
so. Yeah, and these guys still hate it. So.
What about your influences? Would you say that Sick of It All influences you guys at all, or what? I mean,
For me vocally, I would say definitely some of the early New York hardcore. Definitely like 7 Seconds. A lot of the earlier hardcore punk, which would you know would, what they used to call either hardcore or punk back in the day. Mm-hmm. But other vocalists like maybe like Mike McColgan, you know, Dropkick Murphy's first singer. I don't know about influences wise, but I definitely like punk rock in general. Like I've listened to and just kind of definitely shaped how I sing.
Who comes up with the song titles?
Everybody except Brian.
The song
much.
Titles are ridiculous.
They
like,
don't
as,
like my names.
Comedy or something. I mean,
I wanted to name a song called "Put a Little Blood in Your Shart," and they were like, "No, you're not doing that."
This isn't either.
This is
what
I said. Do not turn this microphone on. I don't know why you would do
you're
that.
You're gonna
to
get
us.
Me fired.
Yo, if we give this guy ice cream, we have very long Whoa. Rides.
I go ape shit.
Just want to say that.
I get bad sugar highs.
it's past sugar high. It's like
I mean, even,
I hope it's diabetes at this point.
Even the song, you know, the song that we were just talking about, the bonus track, Crazy Eddie's Business School. It's a, that's
oh, yeah, actually, Brian
that's
did
actually
name
actually
that.
Yeah, I named that one.
We let him name the bonus track.
And you know, I do like the name. So
and Noxious is the most popular one.
Strange Things Are Afoot at the Circle K. I know where that reference is.
Absolutely.
Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
Definitely. Yes.
Hell yeah, man.
Yeah, we a lot of our a lot of our titles are references, but we try not to do it all the time.
To what?
Obviously.
To like all different stuff, like movies and different
movies.
Pop culture
there's
stuff.
there's a comic book in there. There's TV shows mostly.
Yeah,
we're trying not to do that so much moving forward. But you know, we
what happened
had a good time
was well, like a lot of like crummy pop punk bands were naming songs after TV references, so we wanted to make it not cool anymore.
Yeah, well, we want to do
it's great how you guys like use the irony to go against stuff, but then it actually becomes like part of your thing.
Well, you know what the whole thing
like,
is?
The fact that you did that ska song, it was fucking awesome.
The best
right?
was and the one review that's like, I could do without that bonus track at the end, and we're just like, finally, somebody gets it.
Yeah, when somebody hated the ska song, that was our favorite review.
Really?
I do want to say that, like, you know, when somebody, like, when your parents come, it gets shitty, like Facebook. That's kind of what we're trying to do with the song titles. Like, we're trying to show up at your parents with the song titles, and here's a sweater vest, you know, don't forget your scarf.
On the About section on your Bandcamp, it mentioned something about, we like Oscar a lot. Dogs are cool, too. Who the heck is Oscar, man? Because I saw it on your Facebook, too. What's Oscar? Oh, it's a band?
The band? The band Oscar?
Tell me about it.
Oscar
I don't
was the
Oscar.
Yeah. I'm retarded. I apologize.
Oscar is a band that was on Epitaph Records, and they were really famous for not giving a shit about anything. They
Ooh,
they played
okay.
with Guttermouth, and they just like made fun of them the entire time, and they did not care how much. They were the most hated band on Epitaph Records in like the 90s.
I think that's the only
and
time I've ever heard Oscar being called.
And that's what you aspire
famous.
To?
Yes, I don't know if I would call Oscar famous, like in
I
any
called,
way.
I said famous? Oh my God.
Yeah, you did. It was nice, though. It made me feel good. But,
Where are they
say
from?
Oscar was known,
they were from California.
Probably the last good band Epitaph signed. The next signing after them that was Younger Kids was Matchbook Romance from around here. And they went right to shit from there. Warped Tour happened. I mean, basically statutory across America. But Oscar just didn't give a fuck, and they kind of came and went. And that was the last good band Epitaph signed, right up till Off With Their Heads, I would say.
Now, you guys have been around since 2012. Have you been on the road at all?
Yeah.
Any road gigs and stuff?
Yeah, we try to play out as much as possible. We've been as far south as Virginia.
Do you have any crazy, ridiculous road stories?
Brian woke up with pink eye.
It wasn't pink eye. It was an eye infection and strep
very
throat.
Much like
we played two shows in D.C., one in and one outside, and went to sleep at our friend's house inside D.C. And
shout out to Dave.
Yep, Dave. Dave's great. Woke up the next morning. I had what I thought was pink eye in both eyes and what turned out to be bronchitis, and we had a show in Trenton that day. I left the house without my wallet. I don't have my benefit card. I'm like, what do I do? So we're sitting there outside of CVS, and I'm eating cough drops. I'm just like gnawing on them like a squirrel. And we went and did the show. I couldn't even talk between songs, but we just did what we could.
What was great was that morning he woke up, and he was like, you know, everyone was still asleep, and he's like whispering to me. I'm like, oh, he's fine. I'm like, oh, wow, his eyes look a little funky, whatever. And then next thing he's like, no, this is my normal voice.
He's like, oh, my God, no. But, yeah, we played the show that night, and I was in the hospital for like a day and a half.
We set up
that.
Our merch one time, I guess, on the road next to a bunch of dildos.
Tell me that story.
Yes, the
also
dildos.
Trenton, New Jersey.
Pat, yeah, Pat.
Different show, though.
We got there, and as soon as we got there, there's a food truck outside. And standing in line for 5 minutes, we then watched two people get punched in the face. That was pretty nice. And then we went up. Set up our merch table, and it was like someone selling adult toys, which are like dildos, like just right on the table.
I don't think those were made by adults.
I don't think they were made by adults.
There were kids at the show just browsing the line of dildos.
Nice.
And no, their parents weren't like, hey, get away from the dildos. Don't look at the edible underwear.
Yeah, exactly.
I think if there's anything to take away from this, it's that food trucks definitely bring out the worst in people.
Stretch arm dog.
And what food truck?
It's just everybody gets punched.
It was the WTF food truck, so like,
yeah,
what the
that's
fuck?
True.
Like,
how do you guys feel about Dying Scene? Has Dying Scene, being on Dying Scene, has that helped you guys out at all?
Dying
Have you
Scene is
anything good?
Definitely,
from that?
Definitely good press from Dying Scene. And the cool thing about Dying Scene is it's kind of like a punk news, but it's more active. You know, where punk news doesn't update all the time, and if they don't break the news, they're kind of bitches about it. Mm-hmm. And Dying Scene just reports everything, and you get a lot of new music to listen to. And Dying Scene's like probably my favorite site right now in you know, punk rock world. And that's not to slate any of the other sites.
That's awesome, man.
It's also cool because it's like they were the first site to give a shit about us. Like, we're not cool enough for a lot of other sites. Like, we don't play twinkly music, or like we don't talk about pizza and basement with our friends. So mm-hmm. certain sites exclude us automatically. So I think Dying Scene's a good resource, and it's
I think this song is a really good background for this too. I'm sorry, go on.
It's definitely a good outlet.
Oh, on the prairie. Yeah.
Somebody should have been playing a harmonica behind this whole thing. We did not plan this out.
Where can people find your music?
All right, well, you could buy either our 7-inch or our 12-inch from say10records.com. It's say-10. You can also buy it from our Bandcamp, but you know, Say 10 would be preferable, I guess.
Adam's really nice.
Adam is really good, and his
Adam's the most negative
guy. His dog
guy
is adorable, so you should make sure
oh, yeah,
he can
you
feed
guys
it.
Love dogs, right? That's the one. Yeah.
Adam's got a really
a
cute.
No, I have cats, and I despise them both.
What?
Yeah. Every morning
you,
I wake
so
up hoping
so
to find them dead.
That's ironic, too, that you have the fact that you have that written on there? You really don't like dogs?
No, I have no problem with dogs. In fact, his
no,
dog's
think,
one of my favorites.
I think he said he doesn't like
cats.
Yeah. Because
I have two
he
cats.
Dogs.
I just like
who like cats pretty much to be in this band. The only reason I'm in this band is because they're like, you have a bass and you like dogs and you have a dog. So that's why I'm.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry, what's your dog's name, man?
Ranger.
What's your dog's name?
Duncan.
What's your dog's name?
Sammy.
What's your dog's name?
I have only cats and I don't like them.
And they
I don't
want
to talk about them.
Fuck those cats.
Yeah, I every morning I wake up hoping they're dead, but every morning they want more
every
food.
So, do you have any like last words that you want to say to like the people on the internet?
Stop with the porn.
Living
So that track right there is Crazy Eddie's Business School. So, Bobby, it's kind of ironic that you picked that song to play on there, especially since that's the bonus track from Entropy, and they really don't like to claim it's any good. I think it's a great song.
I think it's a great song too, Bob, and I told them that in the interview, as you could just hear. They kind of backfired on them because it's a fucking great song. That's why at the top of the podcast, you chose to play Meat Mattress, right?
It's more of a representation of what their actual sound is. Let's get this straight. They're a hardcore punk rock band with the Orange County sound, Orange County, New York sound, that is, because they're blasting beats far and near because it sounds kick-ass. Seem like pretty cool guys, man. I wish I was over there hanging out with you guys, man. That was looked like a lot of fun. I don't know about the vegan food, Bobby. What did you get to eat?
I didn't eat anything, Bob. I'm in and out. I just show up, get the story. I have the conversation. I shake the hands. I talk punk rock. And then I bounce, Bob.
As you've mentioned before, whenever you do interviews, you like to ask the bands to take you to some sort of a home place for them, something iconic. And they brought you to a vegan restaurant.
Yeah, they did. You know, that was where they played their first show. And then one of them works there, the bassist. The bassist works there. And
oh,
so
well,
that was kind of the joke. They were kind of goofing on him, saying they had just picked him up there. And it was funny, man. We had a blast. We poked some fun. They brought me to school. Every single solitary person that I meet on my journey into punk rock music and learning everything I can about it and reporting the news for DyingScene.com brings me to school on something.
They told you about Oscar, didn't they?
That's right, Bob. They told me about a band called Oscar. Now, Bob, bring me to school.
Well, Oscar was a band that was from Los Angeles, signed back in the late 90s, did some stuff on, you know, your Southern California punk rock labels, your Fat Records and Epitaph. I can't remember which one they were on. I know that for sure they were on my Punk-O-Rama 3 compilation. Great band, man. Just never really broke into the Offspring style of success or NOFX, but still a great band, man. Good stuff, man. It's funny that you guys brought them up.
This band, Oscar, I thought that they had an intriguing story. Entropy taught me about them. They never had a real drummer, but they had these two guys in the band, Dave Benitez and Devin Williams. And I went and I did a little research. I started looking them up on Facebook and stuff like that, reading different articles, you know, whatever. And I got in touch with...
You got in touch with the guys in Oscar?
Well, I got in touch with David Benitez.
Get out. You know. Okay, cool.
But he told me he couldn't talk about Oscar because he was in litigation over it.
Really?
Really.
Over their millions?
I have no idea. I went on the Facebook page of Oscar. I'll read actually verbatim what I put. I just said, is this really the former band members? And then I received a reply. Yup, this page was made by Chris Vaughn, and he got Phil and I to be admins on it. David. And I said, is this Dave Benitez? And he said, yeah. And I said, awesome, bro. Well, I'm Bobby Pickles from the new Dying Scene radio podcast by DyingScene.com, and would love to interview you sometime about Oscar. Why are you guys disbanded? What Devin is up to now, and what sort of music you're currently involved with. And he said, hey, thanks for the offer, but I'd rather not. I'm in litigation about Oscar and can't really talk about it until it's over, which probably will take a few more years. Thanks, though.
There you go, man. That's getting inside baseball right there from Bobby Pickles. Getting that inside nitty-gritty right here on DyingScene.com. Bobby, do you want a good quote from Devin Williams?
Sure.
The split between Dave and I is astounding to me. I always thought that we were the next Simon and Garfunkel. I thought that we would be our generation's Hall & Oates. Of course, I plan on killing Dave.
That's great. I love it.
Oscar broke away from the typical Southern California punk rock scene with the release of their second CD, Idol Will Kill. Previous to this was the first full-length album, Testament 5. Both contain the cynical and snotty lyrics about teen angst, and as a consequence to their stage antics, among which was Devin's brutal sincerity, criticizing conformity in the punk scene, fashion, as well as their crowd-taunting habit. Oscar were labeled as one of the most hated and mean acts on Epitaph.
Interesting stuff.
This is a quote here. I decided that it is just about doing what you want. While you have gallons of mohawks and leather jackets telling you that they do what they want, I don't believe them. I respect the person that says, I don't care for that, because this is no extreme. It's pure sincerity. Punk is doing what you want despite the infiltrators, outside of the skateboards and shoes and hair and patches and the diets and the tattoos. I am Devin, and I have 5 close friends. The rest of the world is divided into the helpers and the clueless.
Yeah, that's true, man. I agree with it.
Let's play some Oscar right here. This track, Strangled, comes from their 2001 Epitaph Records release, Idol Will Kill. It's Strangled on Dying Scene Radio.
I feel strangled. I feel torn into insufficient amounts of dew. Is this a sign?
I'm Colin.
I'm Brian.
I'm Patrick.
And I'm Brian.
And we're Entropy.
You're listening to Dying Scene Radio.
Cast along the shore.
And there you go, man. There's some great stuff from a band that's no longer. Life Support. Rest in peace to those guys, as well as Oscar.
That's an ex-Oscar band member there, Bob. I appreciate you bringing me to school and stuff like that, man, teaching me what I need to know about punk rock music. I think that me being genuine about my ignorance is going to be good for the show, because there might be some people out there that don't know certain things and they might be scared to admit it. I'll be upfront and honest about it. It won't make a lick of difference, Bob, because you know what? I'm co-hosting this podcast with you. We're bringing everybody the news of the week in punk rock land. I'm learning things. They're learning things. You're learning things. We're all learning stuff together. You're bringing us the new music, and I appreciate our partnership. This has been a great episode. What do you think, Bob?
Outstanding, dude. I always have a great time sitting here in this chair talking shit on the internet.
There's nothing more punk rock than podcasting, Bob. I'll say it again, man. It's three chord shit. And you know what? If I wasn't part of this podcast and I just heard it, I would subscribe to it, because it's great to listen to this new music that's coming out. And just like Adam said in Russian Girlfriends, helping to revive a dying scene.
We can all do our parts, man. So that's why we're here every Friday. Make sure you check it out on dyingscene.com. I'm Bob Noxious. Go ahead and send me an email if you want. BobNoxious@dyingscene.com. Find me on Twitter @BobNoxious. Bobby, what do you think? You got any more final words? Did we miss anything?
No, I just want to reaffirm, man, if they want to see these full interviews, go to youtube.com/dyingsceneradio. Check us out on Instagram @dyingsceneradio. Like us on Facebook.
Please.
Right?
Tell your friends.
And then, Bob, do we got the iTunes feed up yet?
Okay, the official word is on that. I'm glad that you brought that up. I have resubmitted the feed. I have yet to be accepted or denied. The first feed was denied. I'm not sure why. They're very, very picky about how you submit the feed. Once you've submitted the feed erroneously, you cannot resubmit it. So it gets ugly.
We'll let you guys know when we're up on iTunes. That'll be a lot better for me. Yeah. I have an iPhone. I know Bob has a Droid, but...
Click on the links provided right there on dyingscene.com.
Absolutely. With Dying Scene Radio from the armpit of America, I'm Bobby Pickles.
And down here in Suitcase City, I'm Bob Noxious. We'll see you guys next week. Dying.